sort of zoom in on the Sacramento metropolitan region, and I've calculated jobs housing balance at the tract level. So our jobs housing balance measure is total jobs divided by total housing units for each census tract. And our color scheme here, red is that. That's more than four jobs per housing unit. That means there's many more jobs than housing units. Green is good. We've got about 1 to 2 jobs per housing unit, and we're going to say that that's basically balanced. Yellow is sort of getting bad, potentially in the danger zone. And blue has less jobs, more housing than jobs. So this is the picture using the straight balance measure. If we instead look at low-wage jobs and affordable housing, we see quite a different picture, right? So places like Roseville and Folsom, these are places that are sort of the affordable housing advocates working in these areas know that these places have problems with affordable housing provision, but weren't able to sort of make the argument that there is actually a problem with using data until Chris and I kind of came along and developed this metric. So quite a different picture in Sacramento. We ran the numbers for the entire state. There's about 7,500 census tracts in California that have data. We can look at the distribution of the scores on the balance measure and compare it to the fit measure. So what I'm showing here is a sort of density plot of jobs housing balance versus jobs housing fit here. So balance is green, fit is orange. And the important takeaway point here is that the balance measure sort of clusters around one across most census tracts in California, meaning that it's going to indicate there's basically no problem for the most part. Things appear to be balanced. But if we look at the low-wage fit, there's much more variation. So in fact, many tracts in California evidence very poor fit on that metric. So if we relied only on balance, we would completely miss this picture. So we think that we're adding quite a bit of value looking at low-wage jobs, affordable housing fit. So it's sometimes helpful to look at a map of an area that I'm familiar with. This is the San Francisco Bay Area. So for folks that don't know, there's sort of San Francisco right here. Go down the peninsula, get into San Jose. This is kind of Silicon Valley area. And then these areas are kind of more affluent suburbs into Concord and Walnut Creek and Pleasanton. That's the city that I talked about earlier with the housing cap. The hash lines indicate our effort at kind of representing the margins of error inherent in the ACS data. But the important takeaways here are that our fit metric shows substantial imbalances in Silicon Valley and into the East Bay. So these results have actually been used for affordable housing advocacy. I have one slide at the end where I'll show some concrete ways that they've been used. Some folks are often surprised that San Francisco pops up as like being mostly okay. I think there are a couple reasons for that. One is that San Francisco has a high minimum wage rate at the city level, so that pushes a lot of jobs out of that lower wage tier. There's also rent controls and sort of a generally high supply of rental housing. And then these data are from 2011, so a lot of the changes that have been happening sort of really currently seeing some of those massive increases in rent prices, so we may not be capturing those in these data. I have another slide later that I'll show that indicates that might in fact be the case. These are the results at the neighborhood level, so calculating for jobs and fit for census tracts, and we see basically a similar picture. We tried to do a little bit of fancier visualization here. So the darker shades indicate tracts that have more jobs. So calling our attention basically to tracts that are potentially more important from an employment perspective. So that's our metric of low-wage jobs housing fit. Now the question that people always ask when Chris and I first developed this is like, okay, well, does it matter? So I started thinking about ways of trying to tie this to some kind of outcome metric. You know, can we start to test whether places that have better fit actually have improved environmental outcomes? So to do that piece, we needed some measure of commute distance. Okay, so this is a variable that's sort of been tested in the literature in the past. We wanted to sort of build off of that. Ideally, I think we would look at vehicle miles traveled, but we don't have mode share data in the LEHD data set. I think there might be an opportunity to kind of peel off modal origin destination matrices from the LEHD data, but I'm not quite there yet. But the LEHD, in addition to having location on workers and jobs, also has origin destination matrices. So huge ODI census block level for the entire United States. So we can use those to look at where people are commuting from and to. So I took that big OD table, looked at every census tract, got a population-weighted centroid as kind of the center of activity, and then I just calculated a straight line distance to every other block in the state, and I calculated a weighted average commute distance for every census tract. So looking at where workers are coming in to each of those census tracts from across the state to get a sort of representative number of average commute distance for workers coming to that tract. So I did that across California. And then our important independent variables were these balance and fit metrics. We want to see if those help to predict commute distance. But there are a number of other things that we know affect commute distance, measures of urban form. So I went to the EPA Smart Location Database, which is a really nice data set. Has a bunch of urban form variables sort of in the 5D category, design, distance of transit, destination accessibility. There are two more as well. Anyway, you'll see the ones that I used. So these are the regression results. Just did an ordinary least squares regression so far, and there are two models. One of total commute distance, so we want to look at whether jobs, housing balance, overall balance predicts commute distance. So that the dependent variables at the top in blue. And then the second model is looking at whether low wage commute distance is predicted by the low wage jobs, housing fit metric. And indeed, we find that all the variables I'm showing here are significant at the 5% level. Most of them, I think all of them actually are more significant than that. Jobs housing balance is positively associated with commute distance, and low wage jobs housing fit is positively associated with low wage commute distance. So as that fit measure worsens, people have to come in from further away. So that's sort of the direction that we would expect. And then a number of the urban form variables are also associated with the dependent variable in the expected direction. So things like employment density is positively associated with commute distance. So people are sort of more willing to travel from further away to areas that have sort of high density and low wage employment. Household density and road network density are negatively associated with commute distance. So these could be measures of urban form, sort of indicate pedestrian friendliness, proximity of destinations. And then nearby transit frequency, somewhat surprisingly, positively associated with commute distance. But we can imagine that if we have nearby transit that's sort of convenient, people might be more willing to locate further away from that job. The transit commute might be less onerous. Included dummy variables as well for urban and suburban locations based on some thresholds included in the Smart Location Database. So these are relative to rural locations, and those are negative, as we would expect. Another surprising result is that the suburban dummy variables are more negative than the urban ones, potentially indicating that there's suburban employment centers in California are pretty important. Anyway, these are preliminary results, so I look forward to kind of discussing them with some of you in the future. They're contained in a TRB paper as well, if folks are interested in that, in looking at the actual coefficients. The R-squareds are low, but I think acceptable for this type of stuff. R-squared for the overall balance model is 0.26, for the low-wage model is 0.29. So my initial hypothesis was that the jobs housing balance measure wouldn't be significant at all, and we would just see significance in the low-wage weighted commute distance, but that's in fact not the case. They both seem to matter. The low-wage model performs somewhat better, has these additional variables we expect to be significant, and the R-squared is slightly higher. But I do need to do a little bit of model tweaking, I think. There's probably some spatial dependence here that I'm not going to take care of, but will in the future. Okay, so the last piece of work, as I mentioned, the first two are kind of static shots of the Bay Area. What's going on right now? What's happening in California? People involved in the Regional Prosperity Plan were interested in looking at what's been the recent change over time. Are these things sort of getting better or worse in the short term? So we went back to the LEHD data and cut up the numbers slightly differently to make some visualizations that describe changes in the housing and job markets. And we wanted to look at a couple of different things. One is this argument, this sort of supply side argument. People, I don't know if this is made across the country, but people in the Bay Area are generally of this mind that actually we shouldn't concentrate on providing affordable housing. We just need to provide more housing in general. That will relieve market pressure. Prices will come down for everyone. We'll sort of get affordable housing. for everyone, and it'll be awesome. Free markets, great. We wanted to see if there was any basis for that, if that was actually happening. We also wanted to identify high and low performers, similar to the jobs housing fit metric. And then we have some preliminary investigation of commute distance implications for new workers in the Bay Area that we can get from the LEHD data as well. There's a pretty nice result there. And again, to examine recent changes. So we looked at the ACS 3-year data. Now what happens with the ACS data is as you go to sort of the shorter time periods, you lose jurisdictions because you're basing it on a smaller sample size, the errors get really big, and the Census Bureau doesn't even include data for some jurisdictions. So all we get using the 3-year data are 19 jurisdictions in the Bay that have consistent housing data available. And this is, you know, this is a lot of places. It accounts for about 60% of the total jobs. You'll see though that over the time period that we looked at, the actual number of jobs changing is really only significant or substantively meaningful for the big three cities. So the big three cities in the Bay Area are San Francisco, San Jose, and Oakland. And they account for about a third of total jobs and about a third of the population. So these are, they're super important. So this first figure is showing change in total jobs on the x-axis over those two kind of 3-year periods that I showed, and change in total housing units on the y-axis. And I've sort of pointed up San Jose, San Francisco, and Oakland. So our takeaway here is that, okay, total jobs are going up, sure. They're going up faster than housing units, but these places are generally adding lots of total housing units. So these are charts that the sort of supply side folks like to see. Total jobs are growing, total housing units are growing, great. But what Chris and I have been doing, our sort of whole argument is that you need to disaggregate these things to sort of make sense of whether growth by job type is matching growth in housing units by affordability level. So this figure is showing change in low-wage jobs on the x-axis and change in affordable rental units. So similar to the variables that we were using to calculate the jobs housing fit metric. I should mention also these gray sort of error bars are just based on the ACS data. I believe it's a 90% confidence interval. So if it crosses over zero, we can't really say if it's positive or negative. The thing to point out here is that San Francisco is a huge outlier. San Francisco added high numbers of low-wage jobs, but probably lost total affordable rental units. Oakland didn't really have much change, also probably lost or didn't change its number of total rental units. San Jose similarly lost sort of net low-wage jobs without adding any affordable rental units. So these are net changes in jobs. We wanted to think about, okay, what are the environmental implications of these changes? So we looked at the locations where new workers were being added. So we can compare the OD matrix from the recent period to the OD matrix from the previous period, and look at those census tracts that are actually adding workers, and then calculate commute distances for those new workers relative to the existing sort of commute distribution. And we get this pretty stark result, which is that we've got three income categories here. So low-wage workers are green dots on the far right here. Middle-wage workers are the orange dots in the middle, and then high-wage workers are the blue dots on the left. And we can see that the sort of incremental commute distance for low-wage workers commuting into San Francisco, San Jose, and Oakland is actually quite high, and it's higher than that for high-wage workers. So it seems very likely that this failure to provide housing that's affordable for low-wage workers is leading to increasing commute distances. Okay, so lending some support to the cross-sectional data that I showed previously. So some key points that I think we can take away from actually all these pieces of work. One is that if we look at aggregate housing production, or if we look at sort of aggregate totals of jobs or housing units, that's definitely going to hide disparities that become evident when we look by affordability level. There's some worrying evidence of long commute distances for new low-wage workers. I think I have to investigate this a little further. There were definitely some of the commute flows that are predicted in the LEHD data. Have you used these data, Giovanni? LEHD? No. Some of the commute flows that are predicted are kind of odd, like people commuting from Los Angeles to San Francisco, that I don't know. I don't know whether they're real. So I need to kind of dig into this a little more and talk to the Census Bureau. But we can importantly update these annually to track progress. So Chris actually emailed me the other day, sort of update these data using the new 2013 numbers. I told him I don't have time to do that, but I will do it. And because I have my open source R scripts, I can just sort of turn the crank, pull all the data off the internet, and generate new figures. So it's pretty nice. I promised that I would show an example of how this has been used in practice. There's a regional transportation planning effort in the Bay Area called Plan Bay Area that was adopted in 2013. It's an integrated transportation land use scenario. There was one scenario that was proposed called the equity, environment, and jobs scenario. And one of the sort of design principles of that scenario was to locate affordable housing in high opportunity suburbs. And that sort of along with a bunch of other different strategies resulted in the EEJ scenario being the environmentally superior alternative. And I think one of the cool things about this scenario, I was involved with the people that were kind of pushing for this, was that it demonstrates this convergence of equity and sustainability. So we can get these equity outcomes that we want along with sustainability. And it's, I mean, in some cases it can be a win-win. There are a number of limitations to the data sets. One in the analysis, one is that the LEHD wage thresholds that I mentioned, those low, middle, and high wage categories, are static. They don't change over time. So the number of workers in the low wage category is going to sort of decrease just as a side effect of inflation. It's not really clear how we're going to deal with that going forward. As I mentioned, there's no modal information in the origin destination data. So all I have information on is commute distances. I don't know whether those are transiting VMTs or greenhouse gas emissions. I just sent in a proposal proposing to do some more work with the ODE matrices from the LEHD. And I think we might be able to estimate some kind of like aggregate mode choice model to split off ODE matrices. I'm not exactly sure. That might be one way we can go forward with that. Another limitation is that I use rental units only, and this is super important in the Bay Area, but if we're doing this in rural Texas or somewhere that has quite a different housing market, we probably want to look also at owned units. Owned units are a little problematic. We've done some work with them, but then you have to make assumptions about sort of mortgage rates, what those are going to be, payback periods, etc. So rental units are sort of more straightforward to work with, but maybe not the best. So to conclude, our fit metric identifies very poor low-wage jobs, affordable housing fit. One of the reviewers was really mad because we had initially called it just jobs housing fit, but he was like, he or she was just like, this is actually a low-wage jobs, affordable housing fit metric. So I'm trying to talk about that, but it's really enough. So there's poor fit, Silicon Valley in the peninsula, in the eastern suburbs, showing some evidence that it's related to increased commute distance, so making that link between equity and sustainability. A number of steps for future work. I think there are some clear things I need to do to basically make modeling better. We can look at alternative affordability thresholds, potentially as Catherine mentioned, and then also keep updating this continuously over time. So here are my acknowledgments. Chris and I wrote up the regional prosperity plan, so there's a report for that last piece. The first piece is in press at Urban Geography, and then the second piece is a TRD paper. So there's stuff written about all this work. If people are interested, I'm happy to share those with you. And I can take any questions now.
The other thing I was thinking, sort of,
assumption itself. So.
Mm-hmm. And there was a simple linear regression model that came to be, then probably you have some plans to develop additional models. Have you tested like transformation of the variables? I mentioned with only log transform between the pieces.
No, but some of them probably should be log transformed. Also, it's not clear whether the relationship with the dependent variable is linear, so I might consider doing categories with the fit measure as well. Yeah, there's definitely more that can be done there. Some of the independent variables are not linear.
Starting from the different variable.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the biggest problem is that there's definitely spatial dependence, and so I need to do some kind of spatial dependence estimation. But I just haven't done that.
And also, that funding, like, you know, between the suburban and urban, you were mentioning distances are tend to be longer for urban, actually.
Yeah.
So that could be like, you know, something related to spatial dependence, or it could be funding actually related to the.
Yeah, I mean, one thing that I'm planning to do is kind of dig in more and look at kind of maybe not estimating sub-regional models, but looking at what's going on at kind of each region. So looking at LA, looking at San Francisco, looking at San Joaquin Valley, to see if there are sort of different relationships that emerge. Yeah.
I was curious, is there any evidence to show that perhaps in other cities where there's some sort of fit or balance between low-wage jobs and low-wage housing, that people who have those kind of jobs and housing will actually live closer to those areas or prefer to live in other places?
Yeah, there. In the paper we reference some literature that looks at exactly that issue. I mean, there's the one sort of argument